2 Corinthians chapter 12 this afternoon. A familiar passage of scripture. Second Corinthians chapter 12. I'm gonna start reading in verse number 7. And here Paul said, and lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. But this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake. For when I'm weak, then am I strong. And I would like to direct your attention to verse number 7 about that thorn in the flesh, and not to bring a message titled The Blessings of Buffeting. The Blessings of Buffeting. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. But Father, we pray that you would again meet with us, use your word to speak to our hearts, and I pray that we'd be able to see your hand in the buffeting that we might be going through at this time. And just bless this message. And I ask you in Jesus' name. Amen. Excuse me. The Christian life is full of paradoxes, contradictions. God doesn't, if you've been saved a while, you realize God doesn't do things like you think he ought to, or like you would, or at least I don't. He said over there in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, he said, you see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called, but God has chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and God has chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty, and base things of the world, and things which are despised hath God chosen, yea, and things that are not, to bring to naught the things that are. When I attempt to do something, I want to get the best possible outcome, the best possible tools to get the best possible outcome that I can. If you're going to work on a car and use tools a lot, you want to get some decent tools. You don't want tools that's going to fall apart. And carpentry, same thing. I tell folks, they ask me, can you get good tools at Harbor Freight? Well, you can. I look at it like this. If you want to use it one time, yeah, it's probably a pretty good economical place to get it. But don't depend on it to make a living with it, because it's going to tear up eventually. Sooner than later. I've got some Harbor Freight stuff. Like I've got an impact wrench to take the lug nuts off my car. I don't do that every day. Just if I get a flat or need to rotate them or something, once every 6 months, I'll break out that impact driver and use it. But if I was doing it every day, I'd go get a Craftsman or whatever a better tool like that would be. And God's not like that. He's looking over there and he needs to get something done. They go down to Harbor Freight and get something cheap. Get something expendable. Get something disposable. Get something foolish. Amen? And the reason he does that, at the end of the thing, when it gets done, the tool can't brag on what it's done. It has to brag on the Lord, because he's the one that did it with the defective tool. And folks, we're defective. If you're looking for perfection, you came to the wrong place. If you're looking for the top notch and top line and the best tool or whatever the greatest tool is, you come to the wrong place. This isn't that place. If you're saved, God's chosen you to be conformed to the image of his son. And he's working on you to perform that end. And one of the ways he does that is through buffeting. And that's what I want to talk about a little bit this afternoon, some truth about buffeting. He said that that messenger of Satan was given to buffet him. He said it was a thorn in the flesh. That doesn't sound to me like something that you'd rejoice in or be glad about. But Paul was. He said that he besought the Lord three times to take it away, but the Lord told him, my grace is sufficient for thee. And he said, therefore, because his grace is sufficient, I'll take pleasure in the infirmities and the reproaches and necessities and persecutions and distresses. I haven't reached that plane yet, that plateau yet, where I rejoice in those things. I'm usually looking for a way to get out of them, to alleviate myself of the problem of the pain. But I would like to, first of all, notice in verse number 7, the pain of buffeting. He said, lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan, to buffet, lest I should be exalted above measure. That buffeting was likened unto a thorn in the flesh, whatever the problem was. I've gone over that with you before. I think it was bad eyesight, painful eyesight. But I'm sure that whatever you may be going through that causes pain to you would be maybe not comparable to what somebody else is going through, but to you, it's real. It's serious. We all have different levels of pain. He likened this to a thorn in the flesh. That's something that we can all identify with. Unless you got neuropathy or something and can't feel a thorn in your flesh, you know what that feels like. It's painful. Amen? We don't like it. You go out and pick blackberries. I took Jennifer and Patty out about 20, about 30 years ago, whatever. My brother-in-law out Morgan City had 40 acres of land and some pasture land where blackberries was growing. He let us come out there and pick them. And it was about this time of year, maybe a little bit early, but it's hot. And I got them all rigged up in jeans and flannel shirts, sprayed off on them. We went out there and was picking blackberries. And I mean, it was hot. We got about two 5 gallon buckets. That's about, I'll just say 25 years ago. I haven't been able to get them back in the blackberry patch since then. You get out there and you get stuck with them things. I planted some at the house and Gilbert gave me some last year, thornless blackberries. Whole lot better. Man, you get in there and pick them up while they, but I've got in the back corner of my house some that wild ones that have grown there. And they got little bitty ones on there. And I thought, well, I'm going to pick them to supplement the ones off of my thornless one. And I got in there and picked them and started getting stuck with them. Brian, just forget it. It's not worth it. Not enough juice for the squeeze, amen, because of them thorns. I planted those in the first ones I planted. My neighbor said, man, you're going to regret that, man. The chiggers would get on you, all them thorns and stuff. And I said, I wouldn't be planting thorned blackberries. These are thornless. And he said, oh, okay, because he knew what thorns were like. They're painful. They hurt. At work, you got to be careful. Where I work, we use a lot of plywood and different kinds of plywood cuts differently. And there's some, like fir plywood, you can get a splinter off those things. Man, it feels like a bamboo. Or what I would think bamboo run up your fingernail would feel like. It is. I got one time, it was about that's probably 3/4 of an inch long, drove into my finger. My first thought is I'm not rejoicing about this thorn in my flesh. I'm not glad about this thorn in my flesh. It's painful. I don't like it. And I just say that to point out that Paul's pain here was likened to a thorn in the flesh. They don't feel good. Thorns are part of the curse. Right? When Adam sinned, the Bible says that the Lord told him, he said, thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat of the herb of the field, and the sweat of thy face shall thou eat bread till thou return to the ground, for out of it thou was taken, and dust thou art, and to dust thou shalt return. We got to deal with thorns because of the curse. Gideon taught some folks a lesson over there in Judges chapter 8. They didn't help him out. Gideon said, therefore, when the Lord hath delivered Zebah and Zalmunna into mine hands, then will I tear your flesh with the thorns of the wilderness and with briars. Teach you a lesson with what? Thorns and briars. The Lord told Israel that if they didn't drive out the inhabitants of Canaan, there would be thorns to them over there in Numbers 33, verse 55. He said, but if you will not drive out the inhabitants of the land from before you, then it shall come to pass that these which ye let remain of them shall be pricks in your eyes and thorns in your sides, shall vex you in the land wherein you dwell. You remember in John chapter 19 in Sunday school, we're going over the pre-crucifixion, the sham trial, and the torture that the Lord endured. One of the things that they tortured him with was a crown of thorns. John chapter 19, they platted a crown of thorns on his head. There was pain in that, pain and buffeting. Buffeting's torture. It hurts. It's spelt like buffet, but it ain't like going to the Golden Corral or the Golden Dragon Chinese restaurant, all you can eat, or the, what's that, 88 buffet? Where old Home Depot used to be. It ain't that kind of buffet. This is a painful one. And it's not the pain of overeating. Buffeting in the Bible in Mark 14:65, it said, and some began to spit on him and to cover his face and to buffet him and to say unto him, prophesy. And the servants did strike him with the palms of their hands. In 1 Corinthians 4:11, Paul said, even unto this present hour, we both hunger and thirst and are naked and are buffeted, have no certain dwelling place. It's painful. And the thorn that Paul had to endure was in his flesh, and it was painful. It was persistent. It's something he dealt with the rest of his life. It's a thorn. It's not easy. Some of you have to deal with it. You're going through it now. All right, that brings me to my second point, the pain of buffeting. Look at the purpose of buffeting. He said there in verse 7, lest I should be exalted above measure. In verse 8, for this thing I besought the Lord thrice that it might depart from me. He said, my grace is sufficient for thee. He's the last part of verse 7, lest I should be exalted above measure. Twice in one verse. The first part, lest I should be exalted above measure, the abundance of revelation. The latter part of it, lest I should be exalted above measure. The revelation that he saw when he was caught up to heaven on his stone there. There's a purpose for it. A purpose for the buffeting. A purpose for the pain. A reason for it. You know, it's easier. I didn't say easy, but easier to endure something if you know there's a reason behind it. A purpose behind it. And the Lord had a purpose for that thorn in the flesh, for his buffeting there. You may not see the purpose or understand the purpose, but you can rest assured that if you have a thorn in the flesh or you're being buffeted, that there's a purpose in it from the Lord. Well, I think one of the blessings that when we get to heaven, the Lord open up our understanding, and they say hindsight's 20/20, we're able to look back and the Lord make clear to us exactly why we went through the things that we've gone through now. Somebody said, heaven's the place of understanding, earth is the place of trust. We'll know when we get to heaven why we had to endure the buffeting. There's a song, an old time song, after what? No. What is it? We'll understand it all by and by. We'll understand it all by and by. Cheer up, my brother. Live in the sunshine. We'll understand it all by and by. You might not understand it here. Just trust the Lord with it. But one of these days, we will. Paul said over there in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, he said, "Now we see through a glass darkly, then face to face." Not face to face yet. He said, "We'll know as we're known." We might not know that now, but when he comes back, we get a new body and we're in heaven, we look back at these things, we'll be able to say, "Oh, yeah, now I see. Now I understand." Right now, we just trust him. There is a purpose for it. Now we see through a glass darkly. Now we walk by faith, not by sight. We trust him. There's a purpose in it. One of the purposes that we have for being buffeted is it regulates the flesh. They said, "Lest I be exalted above measure." Because of all the special blessings that Paul had, he was allowed to enjoy. The Lord balanced it out. He described seeing things when he was caught up to the third heaven, that he saw, heard things that were unspeakable. He was in paradise, and words that are not lawful for a man to utter. He saw the glory and all those things, and the Lord balanced that out with some pain, with thorn, with buffeting. He's writing it in third person, like it's somebody else, but it's really him that experienced that. And because of those special blessings the Lord allowed him to enjoy, the Lord balanced it out with buffeting and regulate that flesh, regulate that ego, regulate that pride, keep it from getting lifted up. Nebuchadnezzar was like that. The Lord regulated his pride. He got out there and looked at all that stuff, and look at all this stuff that my hands has made. And the Lord said, "Okay, buddy, you're gonna go down." And for 7 years, the Lord humbled him, made him live like an animal, took his mind from him. He learned that the Lord's in control, and he just allowed him to be the king of Babylon. And his hair grew out like feathers, his fingernails like claws. He was eating grass. And they drove him out from men, like out there in the pasture, out in the wild, like he would an animal. For 7 years, it was like that. And then he acknowledged that the Lord was God and he was in control. In Daniel chapter 4, verse 37, the Bible says, "Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and extol and honor the King of heaven, all whose works are truth and his ways judgment, and those that walk in pride he is able to abase." That's the way to do it. That's the proper tune. Amen. It took him a while to get to that point, but that's the way to sing that song. The Lord will give you a thorn. He'll allow you to be buffeted to humble you. Somebody said every purebred dog needs enough fleas to remind him that he is a dog. Amen. Now, I don't think you ought to mistreat animals and abuse them or anything like that, but boy, I'm telling you what, our society has gone overboard the other way with animals. Wow. Just you go down to Walmart, they've got a fro or a cooler section where you buy it. You can buy dog food from the cooler, like meat, real meat that's for dogs. And you go over to the, well, that is in the pet food section, but they've got clothes for them, designer collars. These are dogs, folks, and cats. And like I said, I don't think you ought to abuse them, take care of them, or give an animal like that, take care of them. But some people go way overboard on that stuff. Hey, you see these bumper stickers. "I love my Yorkie. I love my grand doggies." I saw one the other day that said, "I'm my doggie's mama." When I was growing up, they had a word for the mom of a dog. I mean, if you're putting that on a bumper sticker like that's something to be proud of. I don't know, man. But that thorn in the flesh that the Lord has allowed you to have. There's a blessing in it. If nothing else, it keep you humble. It regulates that flesh. Paul said, "For this thing I besought the Lord that it might depart from me." And he was praying. He got him praying three times at least. I wonder sometimes if he might have prayed more than that, but just specifically about that, that was a blessing to him, to that the Lord allowed him to have that. Keep him praying. Amen. You got a thorn in your flesh that keeps you praying, keep you close to God, keep you in fellowship with the Lord. John Wesley stayed single for years and years and years. He finally met somebody and married her, and turned out she was like a doggy's mama. Just she would cuss him while he was preaching. Just, if you knew what he did, you wouldn't listen to him, all this kind of stuff. And somebody asked him toward the end of his life what he attributed his ministry to, or the success of it. And he said, "To my wife." And they said, "What do you mean?" He said, "She kept me praying." If it keeps you before the Lord, it might be a good thing. Keep you on your knees. David said over there in Psalm 119:71, "It is good for me that I have been afflicted, that I might learn thy statutes." He said in verse 75, "I know, God, that thy judgments are right, and that thou in faithfulness hast afflicted me." That's not my first response to afflictions, to buffeting, to trial. No, it's a sad commentary on our human nature that a lot of times we have to get in desperate straits before we seek the Lord. And it's got to be really bad trouble, pressing need. It's like that fellow was walking down a dark alley one night. He was confronted by two masked gunmen. Fearing for his life, he throws his hands heavenward and begins to pray, "God, save me. Please save me. I'll do anything, God. I go to the synagogue every day. I'll take the long overdue trip to Israel. I'll give half of my income to charity." About that time, the police car pulls up in the alley. The thugs flee, and Harold looks heaven and says, "Never mind, God. I took care of it myself." Yeah, amen. That's a joke, but that's about the way it is. We tend to treat God like a spare tire. And I'm not saying don't pray when things get bad. You should. But don't let that be the only time you pray. Like that tornado went through Mississippi, and they did an interview with the survivor, and they asked him about it, his thoughts on the thing. He said, I bet the Lord heard a lot of strange voices last night. People wasn't used to pray when a tornado comes through, that they start praying. It's a good time to pray, but it's a good time to pray before the tornado too. Amen. The buffeting rejuvenates your faith, your dependence on God. It regulates the flesh. There's a purpose behind it. The pain of buffeting, the purpose of buffeting, and then the promise in the buffeting. There in verse 9, the first part of it, he said, "My grace is sufficient for thee." A divine sufficiency. He said there was a thorn given to me. Well, who gave it to him? The Lord did. It's like we pray about things and pray for things, and we want the good things, the nice things, the best things. Right? The Lord gives us the necessary thing. It's necessary for him to have a thorn in the flesh to buffet. You ever pray for something like that? I don't. But the Lord sees the need. Gives you a thorn. Gives you some buffeting. Why? Well, there's a promise behind it. My grace is sufficient for thee. Some of you know because you've experienced, did you ever wonder how somebody can go through some of the things that they go through and still be sane, still live? I mean, lose spouse, lose kids like Job did, just over and over and over again, just keep getting slapped, hit, knocked down. How they do that? The grace of God. He said one time where sin did abound, grace did much more abound. Well, I imagine that would fit with the buffeting too. He gave me a thorn in the flesh, but he also gave him grace that was sufficient to bear up on, to deal with it. My grace is sufficient for thee. Webster's defines sufficient as enough, equal to the end proposed, adequate to want, competent. I mean, how could a person live with constant pain? The grace balances it out. The grace is sufficient. How could a person live with sorrow of a lost child or a lost spouse or a lost home or lost health? My grace is sufficient for them. You might not understand it till you've experienced it yourself, but that we have examples in the Bible, Paul, the Apostle Paul being one. He said, my strength is made perfect in weakness. The Lord gets more glory when a person does something for the glory of God under the buffeting. It's like the Lord told Gideon and to whittle down his troops to 300, or he whittled them down. He didn't, the Lord whittled them down. I think he started out with 32,000, and that was insufficient. That wasn't enough. The Midianites were like the grasshoppers that without number. And the Lord told him there in Judges chapter 7, he said, the people that are with thee are too many for me to give the Midianites into their hands, lest Israel vaunt themselves against me, saying, mine own hand has saved me. Now therefore go to proclaim in the ears of the people, saying, whosoever is fearful and afraid, let him return and depart early from Mount Gilead. And they returned to the people 22,000, and there remained 10,000. Then he told him, that's still too many. I mean, Gideon's thinking 32,000 is not enough, and gets it down to 10,000. Well, you know, at least that's a good bit. Maybe be able to get something done. Lord said, that's still too many. Verse 7, the Lord said unto Gideon, by the 300 men that lap will I save you, deliver the Midianites into thine hand, and let all the other people go, every man into his place. That way the Lord gets the credit. The Lord gets the glory. It's like Brother Jack used that example of Fanny Crosby being blinded when she was a child. And most of us look at that as a tragedy, a waste. She was able to write, what'd you tell me? Was it 10,000 poems and songs? Something like 8,000 to 10,000 poems and songs. She probably never would have done that if she hadn't been blinded. I read that book, The Professor and the Madman is the title of it, but it goes into the history of the origin of the Oxford English Dictionary and how it was developed. The madman was somebody, an American that was in a that killed somebody in London, and they put him in prison. Real smart, educated, intelligent. They sent out brochures or pamphlets to get people to help them to discover word origins and things like that to develop the Oxford English Dictionary. This guy's in prison. What else he gonna do? He fills out the application, starts writing these things down that they're asking for, and they get them. And these professors, these scholars are looking at these things and said, man, this is great work. The person who's doing this is top notch. They didn't know he was in prison. They didn't know he was a murderer. Bad man, but the information they get is great, wonderful, and thousands of entries in the Oxford English Dictionary, which is the standard for the English language. I know the Webster's 1828, we like that, but the Oxford English Dictionary is the British standard for definitions of English words. And I was like, in prison that helped develop. I don't think you ought to kill people. I don't think you ought to be a murderer. I don't think you ought to shoot folks. You should. But the Lord worked that out. There was a blessing in it for us. All right. The pain of buffeting, the purpose of buffeting, the promise of buffeting. And last of all, I'd like to say this, the prize in buffeting. There, the latter part of verse 9, he said, most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities and reproaches and necessity and persecutions and distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong. The prize is the power of God. When I'm weak, I'm strong. The prize is the praise. Most gladly, therefore, the prize is peace. I'll take pleasure in infirmities. Paul wrote on top of those Philippians, he said, I've learned at whatever state I am therewith to be content. He said, there's a peace that passes all understanding. How do you get that? That's the power of God, the strength of God. How do you get that? Weakness, reproaches, infirmities. I don't like pain any more than you do. I get in pain. I'm looking for ways to get out of it as quick as I can. I've got a hip replacement in my future, and there's some things that with insurance and age and Medicare and stuff, you gotta, it's like the shell game. You gotta find out which best, what's the best time, all this kind of stuff. And one doctor told me to wait till a certain amount of time because it only lasts, and you had to get another one. So you wanna get it to where you maybe not have to, but then you wanna get it to where you have enough health to recuperate from all this kind of stuff you got to figure out. And I'm thinking, man, I just want to be out of pain. I don't want to hurt. Amen? The Lord's looking for glory. He's looking for humility. He's looking for his strength. Jeremiah wrote over there in Lamentations chapter 3, verse 17, he said, thou hast removed my soul far off from peace. I forgot prosperity. I said, my strength and my hope is perished from the Lord. It gets down to the end of that thing. He said, the Lord is my portion, saith my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good unto them that wait for him, to the soul that seeketh him. It is good that a man should both hope and quietly wait for the salvation of the Lord. There's a prize in buffeting and being buffeted and having a thorn. I don't wish it on anybody. I really don't. But God looks at things differently than I do. He's looking at the long haul. He's looking at the far view. Amen? He's looking at what's best for us, what's best for you as an individual, what's going to draw you closer to Jesus Christ, what's going to enhance your fellowship with the Lord Jesus Christ, and what's going to make you more like the Lord Jesus Christ on a daily basis. That's one of the blessings of being buffeted. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we pray that you'd bless your word, these verses that spoken. I pray that they find a fertile resting ground on the hearts of those of us that have heard it, and the people that may be listening or seeing it on the computer, YouTube video, things like that. My Lord, if somebody hears that it's not been saved and don't understand these things, I pray, Father, they trust thee. Lord Jesus Christ died for their sins, was buried and rose again the third day. If they'll trust him, you'll save them. And I pray that they get saved before it's too late. And then enter into this relationship with thee, have fellowship with thee, and be able to trust thee, Lord, even in the times of buffeting. But thankful, Lord, for your many blessings. Thankful, Lord, for the time that we've had together today, time of fellowship with like-minded believers. We pray for the prayer requests that are mentioned. You take care of the need in each one of them, Lord. And we ask you to watch over us, Lord, as we go our separate ways, and dismiss us with your blessings, Lord. I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. You are dismissed.